my topic today is cytomorphometry in febrile illnesses. And I'm just going to give an overview of what is to come because we have speakers who are going to speak on the various specific diseases. So I will just give you a small overview on how do we use cytomorphometry in febrile illnesses. So in the past meetings, we've discussed the origin of this word cytomorphometry, and we've been saying that it has gained popularity because of these meetings. But I'd like to point out that cytomorphometry, when I did a search, has multiple hits and multiple results. And one of the most credible papers I found was in 1972 saying cytomorphometry of developing rat liver and its application to enzymic differentiation. So it has been there for several years. And of course, automation has made it gain popularity. But what exactly is cytomorphometry? It is the quantitative measurement of cellular features and data points in a software or in a computer via a graphic interface with the intent of standardizing image analysis. So cytomorphometry has been here. It has been used a lot in the past for epithelial cells, and now we use it a lot in hematology. When we say febrile illnesses, let me be very specific. The session today will focus on acute febrile illnesses. All febrile illnesses are not so easy to be included in cytomorphometric evaluation. We are not going to talk of PVOs. We are not going to talk of sepsis at this point in this session. This session will include febrile illnesses, which are defined as a fever of 38 degrees centigrade or higher at presentation, or a history of fever that persisted for, now this is where the definition gets a bit vague. Sometimes it is said as 14 days or 21 days. So I've given a reference of 14 to 21 days with no localizing source. So this is what we will mean by febrile illnesses in this session. So they are called acute undifferentiated febrile illnesses or acute febrile illnesses. This is a terminology which is worldwide accepted, AUFI or AFI. It is a common cause of morbidity and mortality in children and adults. And there is a lack of surveillance, especially in India, because of our geographical variation, seasonal variation. Now, as soon as this session gets over, dengue is already here in some parts of the country. Somewhere it's typhoid, somewhere it's something else. So because of the vast differences in our country, there is a lack of surveillance. We have variable guidelines for fever management. And we have lack of good quality specific diagnostic tests for these febrile illnesses. What are the common causes of acute undifferentiated febrile illnesses in India? I'm specifically talking of only India. Of course, viral, in which you have dengue, Japanese encephalitis, flu, H1N1, chikungunya, hepatitis. Bacterial, where there is leptospira, typhoid, scrub typhus. You'll be surprised how common the resurgence of scrub typhus has been. Rickettsia, protozoal, of course, malaria. In fact, one of the classification classifies them as all malarials and non-malarial diseases, febrile illnesses. Fungal, co-infections of both the above, and the largest part remains unknown etiology. What are the diagnostic tests that we have in to help us investigate acute febrile illnesses? It could be pathogen-specific or pathogen-non-specific. These would include antigen or antibody detection assays, molecular techniques of nucleic acid detection, phenotypic tests, which relies on morphology, for example, blood smear for malaria, or blood culture, which helps you localize a specific pathogen. Now, what about the lack of definitive diagnosis of acute undifferentiated febrile illnesses? Maybe the illness itself is self-limiting. It could be viral infections, while before the patient is fully investigated, he recovers. So you do not have a diagnosis of what the febrile illness was. Semi-quantitative ELISAs, which are used to detect antibodies, may not be conclusive of the present or past infection. Non-compliance of the patients for repeat serological tests. Many of the tests need a second sample, a third sample to confirm, but the patient may not want to give a repeat sample. Diagnostic ELISAs, which are used, could be of poor specificity. They could have cross-reactions. Antigen-based tests may not be freely available. PCR-based tests may not be freely available. that all this leads to lack of definitive diagnosis, and then a lot of them remain unknown. So what happens in the pathogenesis of fever? We know that when there is an infection, there are microbial toxins, there are mediators of inflammation which are released, immune reaction happens, monocytes, macrophages get into play, pyrogenic cytokines are released, and then follows the cascade, which is of course regulated in the hypothalamus. So when there are all the components of the WBC system, the lymphocytes, the monocytes, the neutrophils coming into play in fever, could our high-end hematology analyzers help us in making a diagnosis of acute febrile illnesses? Now, when we talk of cytomorphometry, we moved on to use little more fine-tuned terminologies like cell population data analysis, the help of algorithms of machine learning algorithms or artificial neural networks. All this is a part of cytomorphometry, helping us analyze the cells and breaking up into their functions. Since we are in the CUBE meeting, let me talk of a system of the mind company. You know, I'm not talking of actually company-specific analyzers. I'm here to talk of the application and the science part. But if you see this system, it has various modes. You have the CBC, CBC plus diff mode, CBC plus diff plus the retic mode, CBC plus retic or only the retic mode. And the results which are then generated give you histograms and scatograms. And 3D scatograms. So you have two histograms, seven 2D type of scatograms, and four 3D type of scatograms. 3D, of course, is the hallmark of this machine. And when we say the CUBE technology, when we say SF CUBE technology, we are S is for scatter and F is for fluorescence. Now, this is available in a lot of analyzers, but what makes it unique is the 3D cell analysis. And all this analysis, I will show you the next scatogram, gives you an idea of the cell size, the cellular complexity, and the cellular composition inside, the DNA and RNA information. So when you look at the forward scatter and the side scatter, this is a histogram which is available in most machines. But what is unique here is a 3D interpretation of the cells. And this is how in the diff channel the parameters break up. Now we know all parameters, lympho, mono, neutros, eos, and basos are available in all the reported parameters. But you have something called research parameters. Many machines have research parameters. Here you have HFC percentage, the infected RBCs, the immunoglobulinocyte, of course, which is now a reported parameter. And you have many, many more, which if you evaluate, can help us in the differential diagnosis of febrile illnesses. So you will be surprised to know that this machine, you have most analyzers now, you have a lot of reportable parameters, which can be as much as 37, and also 48 research parameters. Now, in this session, we will stick to the WBC series. There are different sessions on the RBC and the platelet. But if you see, the WBC series itself has so many different kind of parameters. I will take you through each one of them. And then you have the infected RBCs, in which red cells infected with malarial parasites resist a complete lysis and occupy a separate zone. I'm not going to go into detail of infected RBCs, in detail of immature granulocytes, details of HFC, because there are sessions specifically on those to come. Of course, in the COVID times, a lot will be has already been spoken. Ramon will again speak on. This is another specific parameter which is generated called neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio. If you see the lymphocytes and neutrophil here, they split up and an exact ratio is given. I'm not going to steal Ramon's thunder, but this is an additional parameter which is used in investigation of the current pandemic. So let's just focus on these parameters. Do not look here. Various machines will call them differently. But all of them are looking, this is a reference here I have given for this article. So in the WBC channel, the research parameters, you can look at the neutrophil cell complexity. You can look at neutrophils complexity and the width of dispersion. You can look at the neutrophils fluorescence intensity. In the neutrophils fluorescence intensity and the width of dispersion, of course, the neutrophil cell size and the width of dispersion. So when you are getting neutrophil absolute percentage and the count, that's what you are giving in the report. But then you have the ability of looking at the various aspects of neutrophils. This is in the research parameter. Similarly, if you look at the leukocyte cell population data and focus only on the lymphocytes, so you are giving a lymphocyte count, you're giving an absolute count, a percentage, you're looking at the peripheral smear, but the machine itself can tell you the complexity of the lymphocyte, again, the dispersion width, how a lymphocyte fluoresces, and the dispersion of the fluorescence of the lymphocyte. Similarly, in the monocyte series, so the reported parameter, of course, is the count. But then you can look at the amount of granules, the vacuoles, the inclusions in the monocyte, heterogeneity of the monocytes, the amount of DNA and RNA in the monocyte, and the degree of dispersal of the monocyte fluorescence intensity, and the size of the monocytes. All this is available in the research parameter of the monocyte. So if you look at cytomorphometry and cell population data, or if you call it the novel CBC parameters, they may help us to provide rapid and inexpensive information for diagnosis and management of febrile illnesses, as you will see in the sessions to come. It may also help us in understanding the pathophysiology and immune response to diseases. For example, if you're looking at HFC, maybe you want to do flow cytometry and look at what kind of cells are these. These are highly fluorescent, are they B, are they T? If you're looking at immature granulocytes, maybe you want to see later what kind of immature granulocytes are coming up in infections. So we are talking of acute febrile illnesses. What we forget that fever by centuries earlier, if you see, has been a big bane to us. William Osler, way back in 1925, had this very, very remarkable statement which says, humanity has but three great enemies, fever, famine, and war. Of these, by far the greatest and by far the most terrible is fever. So I think these machines, MindRay, cell population data, cytomorphometry, can help us fight the biggest scourge of mankind, which is fever, and help us understand whether we can do something more to fine-tune the diagnosis of acute febrile illnesses. Thank you very much. The sessions which are yet to come will discuss each disease in detail. This was just a brief overview of using cytomorphometry in the diagnosis of acute febrile illnesses. Thank you.